What's up guys, Mike from Rockville, and today I'm gonna show you how to set up your CC8 subwoofer, which is a 70 volt in-ceiling subwoofer. Now this subwoofer can be installed in either a drop ceiling tile or in a sheetrock ceiling, it just depends on your setup. Today I'm going to show you how to install it into a drop ceiling ceiling tile, but the tips and tricks we talk about in this video will also apply to sheetrock ceilings. One thing you'll just want to consider when you're installing it into a sheetrock ceiling is that you have enough headroom. What do I mean by that? Well, as you can see, this subwoofer is a pretty beefy subwoofer with a long profile. This profile is about 9 inches, so if you're installing it into a ceiling, you're going to want to make sure you have about 12 inches of headroom, which means about 12 inches of room from the grill all the way to the back. This will ensure that you have enough room to run all of your speaker wires and secure the additional cable that's required to hold it into place. And we always recommend that if you're installing this into a sheetrock ceiling and maybe it's your first installation, always get a professional opinion before you do the install. Now, whether you're installing it into sheetrock or into a drop ceiling tile, the kit comes with everything you need for a successful install. Over here, we have our metal mounting bracket, which is actually going to sit on top of our ceiling tile. And also included is all the mounting hardware you'll need to connect the pieces together. On top of that, we have a cutout guide, but I'm going to show you a way that you can install it without using the cutout guide. And then some tools that you might need for your installation is a good knife or a box cutter, a Phillips screwdriver, and then a small flathead screwdriver, which we'll use when we're wiring our unit. Now, since this is a 70 volt subwoofer, let me just give you a refresher on what 70 volt technology is. 70 volt technology allows you to set up multiple speakers in a large area or large spaces all throughout your house or commercial space without requiring a lot of amplification. The way that it does this is that each speaker that is 70 volt has a built-in transformer that allows you to pull a fixed amount of wattage from your amplifier to your speaker. Now, on top of this, some 70 volt speakers have the ability to pull a different amount of fixed wattage from the amplifier to the speaker. We call this tapping. Now, where is the tap located on the speaker? Well, if you remove the magnetic grill, you'll see this area over here, and you'll notice these two markings over here that allow us to know what position the tap is set to. So if I take a flathead screwdriver, I can actually put it into the tap over here and then twist it into a position. So over here would be the 6.25 watts position. Over here would be the 12.5 watt position. Here would be the 25 watt position, the 50 watt position. And then this position is the 8 ohm, which means it's bypassing the transformer completely and acting as a standard speaker. Tapping is very important in 70 volt technology and 70 volt systems because you want to make sure that your amplifier that is 70 volt is capable of producing more than enough power to power all of the speakers in your chain. For example, if you had 10 different 70 volt speakers all tapped at around 10 watts, that would be 100 watts of power that your amplifier would need to be able to produce. We always recommend that you pair your speakers with an amplifier that is capable of producing more power than is actually required. So in our example of 10 speakers at 10 watts, which would be 100 watts in total, we recommend you pairing with an amplifier that is easily capable of producing 110 watts or more. And as I mentioned before, there's 4 different positions that you can tap the subwoofer at, so you can always play around with how much power is going to the subwoofer in your system. Just always make sure before you turn on your system, you've run the calculation and know exactly how much watts are in your system and how many watts your amplifier is able to send. And of course, with something like a subwoofer, the more watts you're able to give it, like 50 watts, the better it will sound because it'll drive the speaker a little harder, getting those deeper and punchier bass frequencies. So now, after you've decided what you want to tap the subwoofer at, you go into the wiring phase. So when you're wiring, there's actually this quick Neuroblock disconnect terminal over here on the back. It's this little green part, and you can take it out just by pulling up on it. And now right in my hand, I have the quick disconnect terminal. And you can actually see at the top here, there's a diagram that lets us know which terminal is for which. So the inner two terminals are for actually getting signal into the subwoofer, and the outer terminals here and here are actually to send the signal forward into our chain. Because that's another thing, in 70 volt technology, all of the wiring is parallel wiring, which is really simple to do. You just keep sending the signal forward, connecting positive terminals to the positive terminals with speaker wire, and negative terminals to the negative terminals on your speakers through negative speaker wire, and you send that all the way through the chain from the amplifier to your last speaker. If you want to get a refresher on that, we have a whole wiring video on how to parallel wire in 70 volt systems, so check that out. So if you're looking at the terminals like this, you're going to take your speaker wire that's going to pull music into the subwoofer, put the positive end here and the negative end here, and then you're going to run another set of wires into your next 70 volt speaker with the positive speaker wire going out of the subwoofer here and the negative speaker wire going out of the subwoofer here into your next speaker. Now at this point you would have your subwoofer tapped and your speaker wire ran in and out if you have a longer chain, and we're basically done with our setup. Now that you have a basic understanding of how a 70 volt subwoofer works, how you can tap it, and how the wiring kind of works, let's get to the fun part, which is installing it into your drop ceiling tile. Now, as I mentioned before, it comes with this cutout template, and this cutout template is especially good if you're installing it into a ceiling where it is fixed. You're going to place this on the ceiling, tape it up, cut out around it until this piece comes out, and then you'll basically have an open hole where you can put the subwoofer through. Now, since we're going to be installing it into a drop ceiling tile, we have a little bit more flexibility on how we can actually get the setup. So I'm going to show you an alternative method. Now, for the alternative method, it actually starts with us setting up the mounting bracket. This mounting bracket allows us to actually install this heavy subwoofer on a drop ceiling tile because this bracket is going to support most of its weight. Now, to do that, we're actually going to take the two ends. Now, how do you know if it's upside down or right side up? You always want these walls on the side of it to be facing upwards. So we're going to take either side of the mounting bracket and line it up, connecting them at the middle like this. Remember, we want all the walls to be pointing straight up to the ceiling. Now we're going to grab our hardware. Now we're going to grab our mounting hardware, and I'm going to start with these two long pieces here. These two pieces are used to actually connect this part of the bracket to this part of the bracket. And you do that by taking the long bracket piece over here and placing it over either side of the wall so that you can see all four screw holes nice and clearly. I'm also going to do that on the back part over here, taking my long piece, lining it up with the holes, and sliding it over either side so that it sandwiches it. Furthermore, we have 8 different screws and bolts, and that's what's going to hold all of these brackets into place. So what I like to do first is run all of the screws through. Just make sure that everything's lined up nice and neat. And then you're going to take 4 bolts and just attach them. Now you can do this mostly with hand to start, which I would recommend just until you get all of them locked into place. And then you can take a Phillips screwdriver, pinch the nut to the best of your ability, and then just tighten it a little more. If you need to, you can also use a wrench or another tool to hold the nut into place. And now that I have them nice and tight, I'm going to do the same exact thing on this back plate over here. Once you have your bracket all set up, you can grab your ceiling tile and you're going to place it face down with the back of the ceiling tile facing up. Now I just want to show you that the actual bracket and the cutout guide work perfectly with each other. So you don't actually need to use the cutout guide. You're going to take your mounting bracket and line it up with the walls on this side and this side facing up. You're going to want to do your best to line it up exactly to the center of your ceiling tile. So you're going to also want to make sure to line it up with the edges of the ceiling tile. Once you find a good spot on your ceiling tile, you're then going to go to marking it. Now to mark it, we're actually going to grab something like a permanent marker or a Sharpie, and we're actually going to trace the inside of the mount on the ceiling tile. So let me do that now. You're going to want to make sure that you hold the mount in place as tightly as possible so it's not slipping as you're marking it. You just draw the outline like this. Remember, hold it into place so it doesn't slip. We can remove our mount. And you'll see we have a perfect circle, which is actually going to be the perfect cutout guide for our speaker. Now we can actually begin cutting. So what I always recommend is, since we drew on the inside of the mount, you're actually going to cut alongside the outside of the line. You can also feel free to cut on the inside of the line, and then if there's any tightness, you can always cut away extra pieces. And you're going to want to be as accurate as possible. I recommend doing small movements like this as you cut, because you can always go over it and do bigger movements once you have it clearly cut out. Feel free to do it in sections, cutting out little pieces as you go. Just try to be as controlled and accurate as possible. And if you don't feel confident, always cut a little on the inside, because remember, you can always cut away more, but you can't add anything back. And you can always do a cross slice in the middle like this, which just makes removing the middle a little easier to do. Okay, so now we have a perfect hole in our ceiling tile. Next, we're gonna move to our subwoofer. We're going to first take off the magnetic grill. Just lightly pull off on it, and it should come off pretty easily. We're going to take this subwoofer, and we're going to place it on its woofer like this. Don't worry, it's completely fine for the subwoofer. We're going to take our ceiling tile, run it over it like this. This will be what you look up at the ceiling. We're gonna run that part over the speaker like this. You wanna make sure it sits nice and flat, and that you can see all of this plastic piece of the subwoofer alongside it. Next, we're going to take the mounting bracket like this. Remember, walls always facing up to the ceiling, and place it over the subwoofer, perfectly lining it up with the circular plastic on the subwoofer. You see, it's a nice and perfect fit. Now, before we flip it over to screw everything tightly into place, what we need to do is activate the dog ears. The dog ears are four pieces all alongside the subwoofer. So what you want to do to activate them is simply grab the plastic like this, pull it out, and let it drop like that. You're going to do the same thing on this side, pull it out, let it drop, because this is actually what's going to secure everything to each other to create a nice and tight unit. Do it in the back and on the right side, for you guys the left side. Once we know the dog ears are activated, we're actually going to flip the unit over onto its bottom. To do that, I recommend grabbing it from either side and lightly moving it over. When we have it flipped over, you'll notice these four Phillips screws here. And these are actually what's going to pull the dog ears to create that nice and tight system. So I'm going to grab a Phillips screw gun, and I'm going to just start by screwing them in. So what I recommend is pushing the bracket and the ceiling tile up while you screw in on the dog ear. And you don't have to go all the way in just yet. I would just get everything nice and tight so we can see that it's all even. And I'm actually going to place it on the side so you can see what's happening. So you can see this dog ear over here is actually associated with this screw on the front here. So if I go and screw it just to make sure everything's nice and tight, starts pulling into the bracket for a super tight fit. And you're just gonna do that with all of the four screws, making sure they're extremely tight. Just be careful, you don't wanna over tighten it so that it's actually crumpling the ceiling tile. Once you have that all in place, you can see it's all in the ceiling tile. So now that we actually have the subwoofer in the ceiling tile with the mount holding it nice and secure in place, we can move on to installing it into the actual ceiling where we're going to and run the speaker wire. So let's hop to that. All right, thanks for meeting me over here. I have this speaker in the ceiling tile, and now we are at the place where we're gonna install it in our office. I chose the middle of the room because it just fit our setup a little easier. You can always find the part of your room that's gonna be the best for the sound. Sometimes people like to put subwoofers in the corner because it actually accentuates the bass and makes a bigger sound. You can play around with whatever sounds best in your space. I chose this kind of middle of the conference room, so it's just an even sound all the way through. Let me catch you up to speed on what I did. I also got a steel cable. I ran it onto a steel pipe that is securely attached to the ceiling. That's going to go around this safety loop here. That is very important. You need to run an extra cable, a safety cable around this. So in case, God forbid, anything happens, the subwoofer just has a weird movement or anything, which will definitely not happen, but we always want to be more safe than sorry. You run that cable over this hole over here, run it through the loop, and create a nice tight system so that it will always be secure in the ceiling. You do want to make sure that the slack is very tight. You don't want too much movement in that cable, so measure out whatever works for you. It totally depends on what's above your ceiling, and as you can see in my ceiling, I have a lot of headroom, but remember, in your ceiling, you need at least 12 to 14 inches of headroom. On top of that, I also ran speaker wire that's going to go right into my positive and negative terminals on this unit. I'm using CL2 graded speaker wire, which is safe to be used in your ceiling and your wall. If you want to learn a little bit more about that, we have a whole video showing you how to run speaker wire through your ceiling and into your wall for CL2 rated fire safety rated speaker wire. So definitely check that out. We highly recommend using CL2 rated speaker wire, especially when you're going into the wall and the ceiling, because it's going to make sure that no fires can catch or anything. And that's very important. Our safety is always very important. So I already ran that speaker wire. I used the broomstick method, which is a really cool way to just get wire in between everything when you don't have full ability to the ceiling. Right now, I'm going to run the speaker wire into the unit. So to do that, I loosen this Phillips screw over here. That allows me to pivot and slide out, revealing the EuroBlock terminals. Now, because these are EuroBlock terminals, I can actually pull them straight out. And remember, this one is going to be our positive wire and this one's going to be our negative wire. I'm going to grab my flathead screwdriver over here, just loosen it all the way for the middle two terminals. Now I'm going to run this speaker in parallel to another speaker. I would also be using this outer terminal and this outer terminal to send this signal through, but in this case, this is the last speaker in my chain, so I'm just going to run speaker wire right into it. So now that I have this terminals wide open, before I put the speaker wire into it, you're actually going to want to take your speaker wire and run it through this top piece like this, pulling it out just like that. The reason we do this is because after, we're going to close everything up to create a nice closed system that is free of vibrations. Now that I have it ran it through like this, I'm going to take my positive speaker wire end and I'm going to run it straight into this guy over here. And once I have the positive end in, make sure this is open and then feed the negative end in right beside it. Once we have the positive and negative speaker wire run into our EuroBlock terminal, we can go ahead and reconnect it. We take the EuroBlocks, plug it straight in. Make sure it's nice and tight. Now, after you have your speaker wire in, you're going to take this, close it up like this, and then seal this with your screwdriver. Once that's nice and sealed, we can go ahead and seal this. You want it as tight as possible, and then screw these into place on the side. That's just gonna clamp it all together. And then don't forget to run your safety loop. And now that we have everything installed and ready to go, we can actually put the ceiling tile back in the ceiling. So you're going to go kind of at an angle. Feed it all the way through. Just drop it in like that. At this point, since the grill is magnetic, you can always take it off and adjust the tap. So right now it's in the 8-ohm position. I want to have it set up in the 50-watt position so that I can pull the most power from my 70-volt to this subwoofer. Once you have your tap all set up, throw the magnetic grill back on. The last step is, now that you have it in the ceiling and you have your speaker wire already run through your wall and your ceiling, you're going to take the ends of the open speaker wire and run it into the positive and negative terminals of your 70-volt amplifier or your standard home theater receiver. All right, so I have everything set up. I have the subwoofer in the ceiling. It's the last speaker in my 70-volt chain. I have two speakers on the side running alongside it, and I have everything powered off my RCS 180-6 70-volt amplifier. Let's go ahead and see what it sounds like. I'm actually going to play first just the two basic speakers, and then I'm going to bring in the subwoofer so you can hear what it's doing. So that's just the normal ceiling speakers. Let me bring in the 70-volt sub now. You can see it's handling the bass notes. That's crazy. I've never heard a sub that sounds that good coming from above me, sending the low-end frequencies down into the room. So that sounded amazing, as was to be expected. One thing you do want to play around with is, since the subwoofer is in the ceiling, it's actually going to use the ceiling to create kind of an enclosure that's going to radiate the bass outward. So where you place it in the room could have an effect on the sound, so just keep that in mind and always play around with it. So hopefully this video showed you how easy it is to set up your CC8 70 volt subwoofer in your ceiling. But if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, feel free to reach out to our customer support tech team through phone or email. As always, guys, I'm Mike from Rockville, and I'll see you in the next one.